thank you all very much for coming out this afternoon and spending some time on Tuesday to think about ethics with me. I would first like to thank you all for the invitation to be here, because looking through your previous invitees and your upcoming seminars, I'm in the company of many of the colleagues that I know, and it's wonderful to feel part of that European network. And also thank you, of course, to Helder for organizing it and being very patient with me, as occasionally I didn't respond to emails as quickly as I might have done. So I was invited to talk to you about ethics and ethical review, and I come at this with an anthropological interest. My background is in social anthropology, but I've also been trained in science and technology studies. So that means I have a commitment to studying practices, studying what people actually do, and looking at how they reason around the decisions that they make and the practices that they put in motion. And I've looked at this specifically in relation to ethics. And your EMBL seminar series says that the life sciences have enormous potential, yet a popular consensus needs to be developed around questions of how to assess and deal with the diverse repercussions of that development. And so what I want to do today is take you on a journey to South and East Asia, where I've worked, and to look at the social life of the ethics review committees, which is a form of decision making that has emerged as one of the primary means of assessing and discussing the ethical implications and developments of life sciences and in other sectors as well. Because ethics review is now happening all around the world, and there's a lot of politics in this development. And I'm going to quote again from your seminar series description, which says that the new ways in which science is now being applied for the production of knowledge and economic wealth must be carefully adjusted to public interests and the value systems in each society. So as clinical research, which is what the ethics committees I've studied primarily assess, as clinical research has globalized, so too have the mechanisms for governing it. An ethical review is sometimes seen as a way of doing this careful adjustment to the values and sensitivities of each society. So what I'm going to talk about is this. This is your overview for where we're going, and some context for the research project that I've conducted. So I'm going to give you a very brief history and background into ethical review, because there may be some of you who aren't familiar with the Ethics Committee as a format or where it's come out of, what kinds of histories. And then I'm going to go on and talk about the organization I studied that works across the Asia-Pacific region. So I'm going to tell you what they get up to, but also what I did in order to study them, because when I've spoken with scientists before, often there's a curiosity about what someone does in terms of methods for their research. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about what that actually involved in practice. And then I'm going to describe the work that they do, this capacity building activity in learning how to run an ethics committee, what kinds of questions to ask, and then what are seen as the key areas of that. This is a huge network across the region, and I'm going to tell you what their priorities are and what they see as necessary, how they experience different versions of what ethics is in practice. And I'm going to bring that back to contemporary discussions in Europe at the end, so that we can have a bit of a discussion, hopefully, about the different ways that we can understand what ethics is, how the way the Ethics Review Committee participates in directing, shaping, forming communities around ethical biomedical research. So I don't want to give you a history lecture. It's also not my forte. So I'm going to very briefly say that there are different histories to bioethics and the question of ethics and biomedicine in Europe and in the USA, and each continent effectively has produced a different kind of document to say these are the important, the really, really important things that we want people to pay attention to. And the question of what's at stake in this is often answered with the reply that we want to protect human subjects who participate in biomedical research. So if you guys were to participate in a clinical trial, you would want to be protected by these systems that have been put in place. But another answer to the what is at stake question, which is tied to that, is that there is a sense that unless we have these systems in place, trust may be lost in science. And trust in science is often used as the thing that people are most afraid of losing when faced with new decisions about what mechanisms of oversight should come into laboratories or should come into institutes of research. And I wanted to remind you, if you haven't seen it before, of this front cover of Time magazine, which was circulating in the Asia-Pacific region at the time I was doing my research. And it was there because this is what they wanted to avoid. Any impression, any sense that participants in biomedical research would be human guinea pigs. That was what you had to avoid. So what do you do in order to avoid it? Well, unsurprisingly, ethical review has become one of the cornerstones of attempting to make sure that a conversation is happening around what research proposals are actually becoming research practices. So in that sense, ethics review committees have an enormously important role in determining what kinds of research questions we can ask as scientists. And if you think about that for a moment, what kind of research questions can I ask? How can I do that research? Means that ethics review has become a passage point, a really integrated passage point in the making of good science. But where and what ethics is has shifted over time. And historians of biomedicine and of bioethics actually have identified something of a shift that happened in around the 1980s, which was to take ideas of professional ethics and say, well, we've had a lot of scandals, it's not really good enough what people are doing. So we want to shift the location of responsibility and ethical discussion and oversight into something that is outside the research themselves. Let's have a committee, let's have participants from society, let's have a discussion that happens with outside the discipline or with disciplinary expertise, but not exclusively within the communities of practice. So there's been a shift from professionalism, which was considered important but insufficient, to also requiring committee oversight, and that's more or less the system we have at the moment. And as an anthropologist, I want you to think a little bit about how ethics review committees have become one of the technologies that makes research happen. Most of you who've done research will have gone through an ethics review committee process, or if you've wanted to publish, they might have asked you for evidence of your ethics approval. And so, from my point of view, ethics review becomes part of the technologies that spread with science. And this is a quote Donna Haraway, who's an anthropologist, but she's building on historians of science, Chapin and Schaefer. And she says, experimental philosophy, which in the historian of science mode was science, could spread only as its materialized practices spread. So this was not a question of ideas, but of the apparatus of production of what could count as knowledge. So I'm suggesting to you that ethics review has become part of those materialized practices. You need a room to do ethics review. You need staff. You need resources. And that's all beginning to shift into the Asia-Pacific region, or it has been for a decade or so. But we might ask why. Why is ethics review going global? Why can't we do some research here, we get our ethics approval, we go off and do it, and we come back and we publish? Well, there's lots of different pressures. First, we might look to the regulators, people who receive data, clinical trial data coming in from all over the world, and they say, how do we know that this research has been done well? How do we know that there was agreement locally at the site? Did people want to do this? And so these two are quotes from, one from the EMA and one from the US FDA, in documents around 2010, that sort of time, saying the clinical trial shouldn't take place in a country if there's no ethics committee there. And that's a very strong statement compared to what had been there before. If such a committee doesn't exist, it should be established as a prerequisite before a trial takes place. So this is the recommendation saying, we need these local ethics committees. And the US FDA doesn't have quite such strong language because it doesn't specify the site for that review. But a similar move was happening at the same time. Then there's people who sponsor clinical trial research. And for them, ethics review committees tend not to fall under a normal clinical audit. They don't have access as auditors to the ethics review committees. And so if we listen to what Hamarian and Johansson say, they're clinical auditors who've worked with Roche, they say that the ethics committee is an entity over which sponsor auditors have no jurisdiction, meaning that what's beyond the documentation, what's actually happening in practice, is a complete unknown for the sponsor and their auditors, and that gives a sense of unease. How are you going to know that the committee that you've entrusted your trial production data to is doing a good job? And then there's the researchers themselves. So researchers in the countries where I was working were doing research themselves, they were producing their own protocols, but they were also wanting to participate in multi-sited clinical trials, or often one protocol happening in multiple places at once. But in order for this data to be published, it has to go through ethical review, and this is the sociologist Robert Dingwall saying that this is actually has become an enormous export through the new awareness of journal editors, because unless biomedical research has been approved by an IRB, Institutional Review Board, also known as Ethics Committee, it can't be published in any major journal. Most leading research countries and many lesser ones have therefore installed such systems to maintain access to the international scientific community. So the sense of being, well, we have to have it, otherwise the research that we do won't be published, we won't continue to be part of a global conversation. So when I set out on my research, I wasn't beginning with the regulators in Europe, and I wasn't starting with the NIH or the FDA in America. I started there, in these sense of the other places out there where trial data was being produced. And at one of the early conferences I attended, one of the European regulators said this: sitting in Europe, I rely on data coming mostly from countries in other parts of the world. But if I were to change places and set up in China, the Philippines, in Africa, the USA, or Argentina, wherever I sit as a regulator, I have data coming in from somewhere else. And he was speaking for a sort of collective we here. We think it's very important to set out a network. It's very hard for an inspector to inspect 5 different countries, and it would be impossible to inspect every clinical trial outside Europe. But we receive more and more trials coming from outside Europe. We need a system, we need to network between competent authorities, get some transparency and knowledge of and between different systems. And so this was the vision for what they hoped would come in time. And at the time of the research that I was conducting, when I was in Shanghai observing this conference, the Asia Pacific was one of the fastest growing clinical trial regions in the world. And this actually is a graph displayed by one of the contract research organizations of the Asia Pacific region. So they're obviously saying, you know, loads is happening, come and use us as your CRO. But it's based on clinical trials data from clinicaltrials.gov, where trials are registered. So it shows how many trials and growth in clinical trial activity during that period. So there was an awful lot of stuff going on. So how and why does an anthropologist get into looking at this? Well, as a result of all the stuff going on in the Asia Pacific region, there was a research project funded by the Economic and Social Research Council in the UK called International Science and Bioethics Collaborations. And that was a group of us, 9 researchers, setting out across the Asia Pacific region, mostly Asia rather than Pacific, to look at new collaborations in science. Science was globalizing, nobody quite knew what new social relationships were being set up, who was working with whom, what the new growth areas would be, and the anthropologists were curious about how these relationships were growing and what the new knowledge relationships were going to be. And for my part, I was interested in the capacity building going on in the region. So I was curious about governance. How are different systems of governance being introduced? And one of my colleagues, Bob Simpson, had written some years before that ethics review committees are seen as locally important. Their local decision is seen as important. But what if that decision differs from the one you might take? Local bodies may arrive at different outcomes than their Western counterparts, yet do so using competences that are more closely linked with local cultural values. However, this is not to say that just because decisions are made locally, that they're good or right decisions. And how do you tell them apart? So I ended up wanting to study ethics review committees as they were being set up and as capacity was being built in the Asia Pacific region. And I viewed ethics review committees as a form of social knowledge making. And within the social science world, social knowledge making is a topic for empirical investigation. How do people deliberate? How do they make decisions together? What are the dynamics of a committee meeting group? And so first of all, I was investigating things like capacity building activities from the US and Europe that looked like scholarships. Maybe you would invite someone from an institute to come to yours and spend 6 months learning about how you do your thing. Maybe you would send somebody from Manila to Canberra to learn about bioethics. Perhaps you'd have visiting programs. But what interested me most was this idea of grassroots. And it wasn't my term, it was a term being used in the region. Grassroots organization around ethics and ethical review. And so that's what I ended up studying. And on the left here, I'm going to tell you about, I'm going to give you a bit of acronym soup. So we have to go through some organizational hierarchy for this to make sense. And then I'm going to tell you exactly what I went out and did. So we've got the World Health Organization. They're at the very top of my pyramid. And they run a program called Tropical Disease Research Program. It's got a longer name, but we'll call them Tropical Disease Research Program. Now, under them came this new entity in the year 2000 called the Strategic Initiative in Developing Capacity and Ethical Review. And they're always mouthfuls, these things. But Strategic Initiative in Developing Capacity and Ethical Review really wanted to do what it says on the tin. It wanted to build capacity so that ethics committees knew what they were up to. And they produced regional groups, regional forums, the one of which I studied was the Asia Pacific one, the Forum for Ethics Review Committees of Asia and the Western Pacific. Everybody happy about the hierarchy of entities. World Health Organization, Tropical Disease Research Arm, who funded the Strategic Initiative in Developing Capacity and Ethical Review, whose child body is the Forum for Ethics Review Committees of Asia and the Pacific. Right. Now, because this was a World Health Organization inspired initiative, there are two documents that I want to tell you about that provided a kind of backbone to the ethos of what the capacity building initiative was about. And the first one was the operational guidelines for ethics committees that review by medical research that came out from the World Health Organization in the year 2000. The second one was a document called Surveying and Evaluating Ethics Review Practices. Now, these are important because during the 1990s, there had been, I would almost say vicious, but they had been very, very hard-fought debates in philosophy and in bioethics about whether it was possible to find universal ethical principles. Research was already globalizing, and the question was, can we find things that we really agree on that can provide the foundations for what's going to count as ethical research? And I think the closer people felt that they were getting to an answer of yes, the more answers of no, we have a South American bioethics, or no, we have an Iberian bioethics, or no, we have an Asian bioethics, more of those answers came at the same time. So rather than addressing that big, big debate, what the World Health Organization did at this point was say, here are some operational guidelines. We're not going to tell you what to think. We're not going to tell you which principles to follow. We're just going to say, this is how you run an ethics committee, which is an important shift. And then if you recall the anxiety that the sponsors had about their access to whether or not committees were doing a good job, the second document here, in a sense, begins to answer that concern, because it gives guidelines on how to assess whether an ethics committee is doing a good job. So if we think about ethics committees as assessing a research proposal, that's one order of assessment. The next order of assessment is to assess whether that assessment is a good assessment, which means that you start to get a list of people who you think are doing it well, and maybe a list of people who are not doing it so well. But the orientation with both of these books, which were circulating widely in the Asia Pacific region, was this. They wanted a cooperative and educative model. It was much less concerned with enforcement, partly because nobody had any teeth, nobody could enforce. It was less concerned with enforcement of standards and more with learning, much more with learning from the review of ethics committee practices. So that's an important part of the ethos of these documents that were being produced and how they were being taken up. So I've introduced you already to this organogram. But to go through it again, the Strategic Initiative in Developing Capacity and Ethical Review is right there in the middle on the top slide. This is produced by the Forum of Ethics Review Committees of Asia and Pacific, which I will probably call FERCAP from now on. So we've got the World Health Organization at the top, and you can see that they're also interacting with other NGOs, public sector entities, private sector entities. There on the top left, we have WIRB, which is Western IRB, one of the largest institutional review boards in the US. It's an independent one. And then out of the Strategic Initiative in Developing Capacity and Ethical Review, we get these regional chapters, right? And you can see there that the Forum of Ethics Review Committees of Asia and Pacific has been circled, because it's their slide, that's them. This is kind of like a kinship diagram of the entities in the region. And their ambition, the Strategic Initiative in Developing Capacity and Ethical Review, is externally oriented as much as it is within the region. So it wants to provide the international community not only with a means to build in-country human subject protection programs, so setting up ethics review committees, but also a way to measure and provide accountability regarding the quality and effectiveness of ethical review worldwide. So you can see how that's looking inwards towards the people in the region, but also looking outwards to provide some sense of accountability. And so this second slide here is the strategy that the Forum of Ethics Review Committees took. And these are its three main priorities. It wants capacity building of health research stakeholders. It wants an ethics research infrastructure in the region. And it wants to set a global ethics review system model. So that's a model through which to check whether ethics committees are doing a good job. And it was founded in Bangkok in Thailand in 2000, and this is from their own website, how they describe their origin story. After much thought and deliberation among a group of bioethicists and medical experts, with the objective of fostering an improved understanding and better implementation of ethical review for behavioral and biomedical researches in the region. It's the result of the realization that ethics requires collective wisdom, and there's a need for a systems approach to address important health research issues in the region. Right, so these were the kinds of things that I ended up attending. The annual conference, from which I took that first quote about if I were a regulator sitting in Europe or if I were a regulator sitting in China, where a lot of the networking happens. And then these training sessions, human subject protections, standard operating procedure workshops, surveying ethics review committees. And the biggest part of their year, or the biggest part of what they ended up doing, was a recognition program that I'm going to go on and talk about a bit later. But it was the implementation, effectively, of that second document produced by the World Health Organization. How do you check that an ethics review committee is actually doing a review? Because there was concern at the time about committees that had just been set up on paper. Nobody ever actually met each other, and they would just produce a stamp, and they'd stamp everything, and everything would be fine. How do you check that? So this is the recognition program. And these are figures from 2015. The recognition program is, to me, an absolutely fascinating activity, and I'm going to talk about it in a bit more depth in a minute. But if you're a committee and you want someone else to say you're doing a good job, you invite the Forum of Ethics Review Committees to assess you and to recognize your work. And if they think you're doing a good job, you will get a certificate like this, and you will get a trophy like that. And these are about this big. And you can have that in your office. Well, probably not your own personal office, but in the ethics committee office, it will sit there. And when research investigators come to you with their proposals, this is something that they will see. And what it does is it certifies or recognizes the work of your committee in relation to ICHGCP, Declaration of Helsinki, the SEOMS agreement, the World Health Organization's operational guidelines for ethics committees that review biomedical research, and the list here, and it's signed. So it says, you're doing a good job. Now, when the recognition program began, it was 2005. That year, they reviewed or recognized three committees. By the time I was doing my research in 2009, 2010, that number was 70. In 2015, it was over 200. So this is obviously a very desirable thing for committees. They want to invite FERCAP, and that's the logo up there, to come to their committee, to spend 3 or 4 days looking through their standard operating procedures, looking through the decisions, looking, interviewing their staff, interviewing the secretary of the committee. And you can see from this list the range of countries that have been recognized. These figures are from 2015. Bhutan, 1. China, 76. India, 9. Indonesia, 9. Japan, 1. Malaysia, 2. Philippines, 28, South Korea, 29, Sri Lanka, 4, Taiwan, 24, Thailand, 21. And those of you really familiar with research in the Asia-Pacific region will notice one absence, no Singapore. Singapore doesn't participate in this network, in this program, and doesn't feel the need. So as a result of this extensive work, and I will go into actually what a recognition review entails in a minute. They have received recognition themselves as an organization from both the NIH and the EMA. And these are documents that note that they are making contributions within these regions and that other researchers should be aware of what they're up to. This one from the EMA is the reflection paper on ethical and GCP aspects of clinical trials for medicinal products for human use conducted outside the EU or EEA and submitted for marketing authorization. And the NIH one is a similar kind of thing. So this is the timeline over which the committees are working. The organizations, the NGOs are working, founded in 2000, and working together, working concurrently, and they're very busy today. So as an anthropologist, interested in the spread of ethics review into the Asia-Pacific region, interested in the way that ethics was being taken up in different places, I ended up following them around. The Forum for Ethics Review Committees became my field site, and wherever they went, I tried to go. So these yellow pin dots here are places that I conducted either ethnographic research or interviews or observations. I started in Sri Lanka, which is down there, and I interviewed a bunch of committees there, but then I realized the Forum for Ethics Review Committees was visiting and going back to its home base, which is in Bangkok. They're based at Thammasat University, just north of Bangkok. And so I went there, I spent a little bit of time, but I realized that if I stayed there to study them, I would miss pretty much everything of what they were doing because they were traveling across the whole region, doing their trainings and doing the recognition program. So I followed them wherever they went. And for this period of time, between 2009 and 2010, I was burning my project's research budget by following them around. So I was in Manila, I was in Taiwan, I was in mainland China, I was all across Thailand as well. So it was mostly ethnographic fieldwork, but I also conducted interviews with pretty much anyone who would agree to speak with me about why they were involved in the network and what they were up to. So we come on to what they get up to and the kinds of observations that I was able to make by participating and observing in their capacity building activities. Because making an ethics review committee isn't simply a matter of making sure that there's a room or making sure that you've got standard operating procedures. It is those things, but it's more as well. So if we look at how FERCAP, the Forum of Ethics Review Committees, describe their own work, they consider themselves to be within a globalizing environment. And they would say that they see the same clinical trial being done there in Asia, they see it being done in Africa and in the West. And this quote here comes from a pitch that FERCAP was making to a committee that hadn't yet gone in for recognition. And it was saying to them, well, you know, it's really important that you get yourselves recognized because there's so much interaction between sites now that you need to be able to say what kind of review that you do. In your cancer center, you're doing some of the global trials. I've visited many countries in Asia, and this is the person who's promoting the Forum of Ethics Review Committees. I see the same design being adopted, one protocol done in different countries all at the same time. So their orientation is towards the committees themselves, and this is important, because when we think about what ethics in relation to biomedical research is, there are many possible audiences. We might have publics, we might have individual researchers. But they say, we're not a human rights program that would work with the masses and make them agitate for regulation. We're trying to create a duty-based ethics. If you don't do your duty, then you're not a good professional. We're not working with patient groups. Our audiences are the doctors, the academics, and the regulators. So you're seeing there in their self-description exactly how they're orienting where they see their intervention. So what kind of problems in the Asia-Pacific region did they see? Well, as you saw from the big list of committees that have wanted to be recognized, this is a hugely varied region. Different countries have different regulations, different countries have different priorities, different countries have different capacities to host and conduct research. This is not necessarily a problem, but it does create challenges to a program oriented towards making sure that the operation of committees is becoming more standardized. The organization itself had very varied and uncertain funding, so they didn't always know that they were going to be able to continue their work. They also found that ethics review committees wanted to follow up on the reviews that they did, but didn't always have the resources to be able to. And there were a lot of debates about whether or not an ethics review committee should do a scientific review as well. And this has been an ongoing debate for some time. But if you think about being faced with a research protocol, if you don't understand or don't have any expertise in the science that's being proposed as the research, it's difficult to make an ethical assessment, because if it's bad science, if it's not going to produce any kind of valid data, then it's unethical to subject anybody to that project. So there was a debate about the extent to which ethics review committees needed to be able to draw on expertise either within their own country or across the region to conduct a scientific review as well, or beforehand, or not at all. And here we get the problems as seen from the point of view of the sponsors. This is a slide from GCP audits, which were being done by mostly clinical trial auditors in 2005. And it was used as a reference point for the starting of the recognition program, which was about making better ethics committees, basically. So they needed a starting point, they needed a benchmark. And they took this from Beat Widler and Alan Johansson, who both of whom have worked for Roche and other pharmaceuticals, but had been also involved with the establishment of the Forum of Ethics Review Committees as supporters for the improvement of standards in ethical review. And these were the non-compliance issues, and they've called them IRBs, which is mostly the language used in America for institutional review boards. And it varies across the region as to whether people call them institutional review boards or ethics committees, depending on whether they're more oriented towards America and attracting American projects and funds, or if they are feeling that they're more into Europe and the World Health Organization. But these were the big issues in 2005. No written procedures, inadequate composition and poor attendance, meetings by emails, not face-to-face, expedited review procedures not defined, timelines for submission not specified. So the big one here is the first one. To operate without written procedures as an ethics review committee is a major violation of good clinical practice. And it means that if you have data that's coming from that site, it might not actually be valid for submission to regulators because your ethics review committee has no written procedures. So five years later in 2010, FERCAP produced their own survey, or rather they looked at the findings of their recognition program to look for common weaknesses. What had changed? What was the same? And this big issue of not having written procedures had changed. It had gone away, but it had turned into a different kind of problem. So they had, as the second point, incomplete standard operating procedures and inadequate standard operating procedure compliance. So your standard operating procedures say, this is how you run a committee. This is what you do when this happens. This is what you do when that happens. And standard operating procedures, as I showed on the slide earlier, were one of the focus areas for addressing the lack of written procedures when a committee got together. There was nothing to say, this is what we do as a committee. And there were a range of other common weaknesses identified in 2010. But one question that perhaps arises at this point, having explained to you that this is a big program of training and recognizing ethics review committees in the region, are they doing bioethics? Is this actually not bioethics? Surely it's pretty related to bioethics. It's about how you make a decision about ethics. These two examples on the left, I'm going to read them out to you. I think it gets a bit bigger. Are two encounters that were told to me by members of FERCAP, the Forum of Ethics Review Committee of Asia and the Pacific, about their engagements with international global health or bioethics organizations or programs. So there was the NIH Poverty International Center and the Harvard School of Public Health, both of whom were actively doing capacity building activities in the region. And I want you to experience these encounters because it shows the different approach to ethics that is being taken here. So the first one is from someone who had attended an event in China, and these Harvard fellows that are being referred to in the first sentence are people who'd attended the School for Public Health summer schools or training courses. Some Harvard fellows also work with us being FERCAP. That's when it gets complicated. Bioethicists in China, they are philosophers. So they think we belong to one group, us, FERCAP, and the bioethicists. They belong to one group. When you do training, they put us together. with bioethics lectures. We had a session on standard operating procedures, the management of serious adverse events, and then the Chinese philosophy people talked about principles. They were talking about whether there's an objective reality. I understand that because I'm coming from a social science background. I've been exposed to these things at the university, radical sociology. But can you imagine doctors listening to that? How can you tell which drug is more effective if there's no objective reality? Meiji, who was her colleague in the organization, she was doing the translation for me, and I asked her what they were talking about. And she shook her head and said, I cannot translate this. I just don't know how to. She's a very smart medical doctor, but she will just stop doing the translation because she says, I don't know how to translate that. Even she gets confused. And this second one took place in the Philippines in Manila, and it was based on a Fogarty International Center event that was to bring together doctors and people who talk about ethics. So there was a lot of discussion in setting this event up. Fogarty wanted a course on moral dilemmas. They said it was a skills course. Doctors in the course said, this is a never-ending discussion. Suppose someone is run over by a car, who's responsible? The driver. Suppose the pedestrian is drunk? Well, both. But then say the driver does this, and you keep adding to the issue. It goes on and on. The medical doctors, they said, there is no resolution to this. That was the skill that they learned. They said it's a very different approach. So instead of dealing with bioethics or going there, the Forum for Ethics Review Committee said, well, what's the point of talking about these things when we're talking about research ethics? For us, the guidelines are there. For us, more important is to be able to operationalize those guidelines. If a new issue comes up and they can incorporate it into the guidelines, we'll follow it. We'll start implementing. So this is published as part of their orientation. The approach, they say, has made it possible to operationalize the basic ethics principles of autonomy, beneficence, and justice in the review of health research and translate them into tools such as checklists, assessment forms to assist committee members in reviewing protocols, consent forms, and related documents. That's how they orient themselves towards a good ethical review. But they go in slightly different directions when it comes to actually training people and encountering them face to face. Trainings take a lot of forms. As I mentioned, you might go to a training on standard operating procedures to know how to run your committee better. But the most effective one was seen to be that on research ethics itself and the histories of bioethics, perhaps slightly surprisingly given what I've just said. So here we have the Forum of Ethics Review Committee's Asia and the Pacific logo. And I did ask about this at one point. And the story was that it was the flame of enlightenment to revise and fan a passion for ethics and research. And in practice, this often meant engaging with participants in a training in a way that wasn't about procedures. It was about something else. At the beginning of the training on research ethics, the participants wouldn't care. This is a trainer speaking. But then they start to listen. If the workshop is one of the most transformative. At the beginning, they don't care, and then they hear this, and you see them change. And I said, well, you know, isn't that the case with most trainings? You would hope that that would be the outcome. And the trainer explained to me that this was more about really shifting and opening the eyes of people who were participating. And her example was about riding a bicycle as a way of making me understand, as someone who'd also ridden a bicycle, what kind of transformation she was hoping for. You can ride a bicycle now, but before you could, why was it so hard? Do you remember that first time, that moment, the first time you rode the bike? You remember it. I try and find examples. What does it mean? They're asking themselves about ethics. What does it mean? You can't do it. You can't do it, and then suddenly you can do it. She wants you to take that moment and understand that that's the kind of transformation in thinking about ethics that she desires to see and does see sometimes. She has a much more personal orientation than a standard operating procedure that you follow. And the uptake of these trainings wasn't always that of transformation. Sometimes people said, well, this is coming from somewhere else. And this is a quote from a Taiwanese researcher who told me that America has the Belmont Report, a widely circulating document about research ethics principles. Europe has Helsinki. We have Confucius. It just depends if you want to do it or not. And his explanation to me of putting these two formalistic documents alongside a philosopher like Confucius was that he felt within Chinese upbringing, training philosophy, that the underlying assumption was that people were good. And he felt that these documents represented the Westerners' underlying assumption was that people were bad. So that's why there were so many regulations and documents. he in Taiwan thought, well, you know, mostly people are good, we just need a bit of help from time to time. So this led to a discourse about believing in ethics. And these two quotes, one of them is published and one of them is a sort of conversion experience, show that when you are actually faced with people in a training situation, there are some things that help them understand what ethics could or should be. And the Sumathipala is a Sri Lankan bioethicist, and he said that you need to guide researchers to do quality research because they believe in the ethical framework. You want someone to become an ethical researcher because they believe in it, not because someone has started to police you. And here you start seeing the distinction between an ethics review committee that goes through its proceedings and says, yes, you can do this research or not do this research, an idea about practicing ethics, believing in it, integrating it, being transformed by it. So those are a couple of the tensions within trainings. What about this recognition program that I talked about? Why has this been so successful? And how does it contribute to the idea of a good ethical review? Well, we might first look at what the standards are. And I've put the Strategic Initiative in Developing Capacity of Ethical Review on the top of there because they are the guys who came up with these standards. These are the five standards that are used to assess whether or not a committee should be recognized. They look at the structure and composition of the committee, whether it adheres to specific policies, and these are listed, the completeness of its review process, including whether they follow up and how quickly they do the review, whether they do after-review follow-up activities, how well they communicate their decisions to investigators, and then how well they document and archive. You might see these as fairly fundamental components of making an ethics review. But if you and I were to go around, say, Germany, wanting to assess whether or not ethics review committees were doing all of these things, it would take us some time. It would also be pretty expensive. We've got to travel there, we've got to stay somewhere, we've got to spend 4 days reading standard operating procedures, eating a lot of food. It costs money. So how does a grassroots, non-governmental organization with precarious funding manage to recognize over 200 committees within the first 5, 15, 10 years, 10 years of its establishment? You can't quite see it at the top, but that word says collaboration. It's based on volunteering. So if you're on a committee and someone has come to you and assessed your committee, you are then being trained through that process to go and assess someone else's committee. This is a very intentional design. It's intentional on the part of the people who run the Forum of Ethics Review Committees. And they say everyone is talking about the same goal that everyone contributes to. Instead of competing or being jealous, because of exchanging ideas, people are accountable to one another. And this accountability, they say, leads to a common interest in the quality of the recognition program. If I just let you do whatever you want to do, really, then the recognition that I've got loses value. So it becomes what they describe as a self-sustaining system, made up of equally invested partners in this dance of reversing places. I review you, you review me. And it's not always that direct. You might go and review someone else, and they'll review someone else. It's a big network. But it's about making a model that makes everybody invest in quality. And you think, oh, well, that's lovely. But what also keeps it going is a huge amount of competition. And here's someone with his certificate in Thailand looking very pleased. When I listed the countries on the slide and how many committees they had, this was a bone of great contention during my research, particularly between countries that wanted to attract similar kinds of projects or wanted to do similar kinds of research. So we're talking about South Korea and Taiwan particularly. And a secretary that I was interviewing in Taipei, during our interview, went to the internet portal to see how many committees were currently recognized in South Korea. And she found that there were 23. And she knew that Taiwan had 25, and so she thought that was a pretty good thing. And this is what she said. We like competition. If you're independent and I have AHRQ, which is a different recognition system, or the Forum of Ethics Review Committee's recognition, and you don't have it, people will think your IRB is not good enough, and that's the reason we have to get more and more. And I say, why? You know, I can't quite understand what's driving this desire to invite people to assess and judge you. And she says, well, we want to be famous. Within this world, you get recognition, everyone thinks you have an international level quality. And she said, there's also a dimension of feeling proud as a researcher. I feel proud. If I got FERCAP recognition, it means that we're well organized, our procedures are no problem. Right? And then she added this. Just as some institutions are proud of AHOP put the accreditation mark on their website, they show themselves and the world that they are excellent. Now, I mentioned AHOP at the top of this and the bottom of this competition slide for a reason. The Forum of Ethics Review Committees of Asia Pacific is a grassroots organization by its own admission. But there is another entity entering this sector of assessing the practices of ethics review committees. And that is the Association for the Accreditation of Human Research Protection Programs. Aren't you all happy that you have to deal with other kinds of acronyms than the ones that I deal with? This is an American accreditation organization. They are full-on auditors. They will ask you for money, and they will come and do their assessment. They will look at the entire institution. You will get your accreditation, and you can put your sticker on your website. This is the top left-hand corner, full accreditation. And I wanted to draw on this to make a contrast, because FERCAP describes itself as a foundation project, a capacity building project. It wants to do capacity building from ground zero, which is a quote from an interviewee. Whereas to them, AHOP was already at the top floor of the skyscraper, giving the sign of the qualified. So at the time of the research that I was doing, there was anxiety about having an American accreditation organization entering this space for assessing the quality of ethical review. They said, well, it might raise standards on the surface, but we're worried about whether it will allow actual practices to suffer. Other groups who validate, their mission is to evaluate, and that's it. That's all they're interested in. FERCAP is not about evaluation alone. The intention is to assist and to recognize. It's about building a community of people who are equally invested in improving ethical review and dealing with new challenges that come along from new technologies. And this is a quote on the right here from one of the committees in India that had decided to go straight for AHOP and to bypass the Forum of Ethics Review Committees completely. And their justification was they thought it was the next logical step for their program to send a message to the rest of the research institutes. If they're serious about clinical research, they should be thinking about AHOP accreditation. So at the bottom of each of these slides, I've put a note on which scale of change is targeted. In the first one, we had trainings that were largely targeted at individual transformation. In the middle, we had institutional change. Institutions, they would support their committees in getting the necessary facilities to go for the recognition program. And here we have a change which is more sectoral. What's happening between these different entities that might recognize the work of ethics review committees? We might also pause there for a moment to think about why it is a NGO operating across the region that is saying, yes, this is good work on the part of ethics committees. What happens to national bodies? What is their role in this? What if there is no national body that is interested in what kind of work ethics review committees are doing? What if the ethics review committee of the capital city is actually the first port of call for a researcher from, say, a university in the US wanting to do research in that country? That's the only, or perhaps first and only, engagement with ethics for that nation, the one committee in the one capital, in the one university. So, all of this work has been going on across the Asia-Pacific region for 10 years or so, a bit more. And they've been very successful. They have a big community. They work to support one another. But at the same time, in the countries where ethics review was developed and where it became established through the 70s and 80s, there are questions being asked of it. And here are three quotes from researchers in the US and in Canada, asking questions about what ethics review actually does for research. Is it the right place for ethics discussions to happen? Have we delegated our conversations about ethics as a society to the right entity? This first one is from a guy called Greg Kosky, who used to work for the Office of Human Research Protections in the US. And he said that there was little direct measurable evidence that the heightened burden of review actually increases the effectiveness of protecting human subjects or improves the quality of research itself. And then you have researchers in Canada who are interested in this too. A great deal of the story about ethics review is that researchers hate it, but we have to do it. And so researchers have looked into this. And Began and McDonald said, well, almost all of the participants in their study believed, often passionately, that ethics review was effective, but the empirical evidence they offered for or against such claims was scant. And they said, well, it's quite surprising that, you know, scientists will run for evidence-based everything except ethical review. Where is the evidence? And then we have a Holly Taylor in Canada also saying that in the absence of empirical evidence regarding the quality of view or its effects, the people she interviewed said they relied heavily on the integrity of researchers, and they professed a cultural norm that the integrity of researchers was not to be questioned. So what is it that ethics review committees are about? We've had different ways of thinking about ethics in the three modes of engagement that FERCAP has with its participants. We had targeting individual senses of belief in ethics and wanting to do it yourself. We've looked at the way institutions can become proud of themselves or want to present a kind of image to the world. We've also had whole sectoral images of whether or not you are going to receive a form of accreditation. Someone else says that you're doing a good job. And to me, these are contrasting logics of improvement. And they also pose the question, ongoing question, that I'm not going to resolve today, of how ethics should be understood. Because through ethics review committees and IRBs, there's a great push towards standardizing things, making things interoperable across contexts. And that is natural with the result, with the growth of global research. Much more simple. If you can have your protocol, you can design it here, you can run it the same over whichever multiple sites you want to. And I found that to be not a common perspective amongst the people I interviewed, but it was a desire that was expressed. This guy I interviewed in Sri Lanka ran a hematology laboratory, and he made a direct analogy between his practice in the lab and his role on the ethics review committees. He said, for the laboratories, we get international recognition. When you come to the hospital, you don't have to worry about the quality of the service. If you have your own level of guidelines, so if Sri Lanka developed its own guidelines, you would automatically be differing from other countries. And his question was, how much are the gaps a problem? Which ones are not going to be acceptable? And his example particularly was diabetes. And his example was, you expect the standard when you diagnose diabetes in the UK, the US, and Sri Lanka to be the same. It's the way he thinks about scientific principles and global research. And he said, well, it's the same with ethics. If we as Sri Lankans try to stick our own principles and guidelines into the mix, we'll try and avoid some aspects of guidelines practiced in other countries. This might be advantageous for our researchers, but considering internationalism and globalization, will it be acceptable internationally? So his solution was to ensure that there was an ISO standard for ethics, as there was for his laboratory. But there's also a push in more or less the opposite direction, which comes out of these assessments from the US and Canada saying, well, we don't really know whether ethics review of research is producing better research, whether it's producing more ethical researchers. And these two quotes, the top one again is Canadians, and the bottom one again is Greg Kosky. And they're calling on very different ways of thinking about ethics. Not to make a set of common standards for interoperability of research across the world, but to say that neither economic incentives, nor technology, nor administrative control have provided an effective surrogate for the commitment to integrity invoked in the ideal of professionalism. So you can see that we're going back to this idea that I introduced at the very beginning of a shift between, or ongoing oscillation perhaps, between locating ethics in individuals and in their professional integrity and ensuring that there is oversight of them, that it gets externalized from the individual discipline. And Kosky's take was, we have to say, we being the community of people interested in ethical review, all right, we're really talking about integrity here. Integrity is what we're falling back on in the hope that that's what's going to protect human subjects, not a committee, not regulations. Now, I don't want to say that the division is as stark as all that or that it's sustained in that way in all settings. But if we bring the debates that I've just described in the Asia-Pacific region and the approaches that we saw that FERCAP was taking back to Europe, we find an open and ongoing debate, pulling in different directions not necessarily contradictory, but also not necessarily supportive of one another. And what I'm talking about here is the push to see ethics in a form that can be an ISO standard, which is oriented quite strongly towards how you do this. So it's aligned with what FERCAP is trying to do across Asia, to provide committees with instructions of how you run this committee well. But as an ethnographer of these committees and how you implement these standards, it's not easy to keep form and content separate. You might think that you're making standards for the form of decision making, but it's very difficult to do that without in some ways affecting and addressing the content of those discussions and decisions, because the form has an effect on what kinds of conversations you can have. And so from my position in Denmark, I've been involved in a couple of projects. The one on the left here is a Horizon 2020 on FP7 project, I think, called Stakeholders Acting Together on the Ethical Impact Assessment of Research and Innovation. So it's a European funded project, and one of its initial ambitions was to produce an ISO standard for ethics. And so they did a huge amount of groundwork looking at more or less what FERCAP was looking at across Asia. What are the differences between countries? How have they institutionalized ethics review differently? Have they got national boards? Have they got institutional boards? What have they done? And out of this, they decided that probably making an ISO standard at this point was too difficult, but they have done one step down from an ISO standard, which attempts to bring all of this vast debate around what ethics review should be and could be institutionally into an agreed upon form. One anxiety around that is that it turns ethics into a question of compliance. It's a very long way from ideas of belief, about believing in ethics or being converted or wanting to do it yourself. And so at the other end of that spectrum, there's been a rise in discussions about research integrity, as came up in the slides near the end. This is the All European Academies booklet, the European Code of Conduct for Research Integrity, that was recently revised. And one of the projects I'm on now is looking at the very different history that research integrity has from that of research ethics and ethics review committees, and how the idea of integrity shapes what an ethical subject or what an ethical institution or ethical environment is going to be differently from a standards-oriented approach. And if I were to close with some thoughts on what these different versions that I've looked at across the Asia-Pacific region and in Europe mean, we have a situation now where we have delegated a lot of our decision-making to committees like the ones I've been describing. And I think what's valuable about looking to regions like the Asia-Pacific and looking at the practices of FERCAP and of the Strategic Initiative and Developing Capacity and Ethical Review is that they often do a lot more than we might do in Europe, but they allow us to question how a good ethical review is thought of, implemented, designed, checked up on, and forces us to question whether ethics review is a good way of having those discussions, whether they should be happening in these committees or in multiple other forums through individual training or through forms of audit and assessment. So I'm going to leave it there, and hopefully we'll have some material for debate and discussion. One of the really impressive things is how much they actually talk to each other. I've done research on ethics review committees in the US, actually embryonic stem cell research ethics committees, so they're not IRBs. And it was really surprising to me how little committees actually talk with one another about common issues. So if it's not already done across European countries, I think having forums through which common concerns can be discussed is actually a really important and useful way of sharing committee practices and also engagements with wider communities, because ethics review committees have a very strange identity within many research communities, because they are loved or loathed, effectively. people think they are absolutely necessary and wonderful, or they think they are a dreadful and bureaucratic burden. Members of the committee. Yeah.
Is there any discussion in this scene on the possibility of conflicts of interest between someone's role as a researcher and as a committee member?
Absolutely, yeah. In this setting, an awful lot of the committees that get set up because someone wants to do research and they need to get it reviewed. And so conflict of interest becomes one of these training themes that the Forum of Ethics Review Committee runs quite a lot. And I really enjoyed sitting in on those trainings, because how you explain that difference between being a researcher and being a committee member makes people draw on all sorts of examples to create analogies, to show where the separations need to be drawn or why people think those separations need to be drawn. How do you get someone to imagine themselves what something looks like from outside? How do you get somebody to realise that their friendship with somebody is potentially what is known as a conflict of interest if you've never encountered the concept of a conflict of interest before? And it's also a question of resources, because most of these committees, they're not commercial, they're not paid to do the reviews, and so they are staffed by researchers, and in differing settings this becomes more of a problem or less of a problem. In Sri Lanka and Thailand, I had interviewees who were either lay members or just regular members of committees saying to me that they very much struggled to separate out their professional relationships with people, where they knew they had to continue to be employed, or from the need or desire to make an ethical contribution. But I don't want to suggest that that's exclusive to South or East Asian settings, where hierarchy is often described as one of the features of society, because it's exactly the same thing that Laura Stark finds in the US, that there are members of committees who are, say, a postdoc, and they know that their colleague two removed, they should probably change something about their research, but they also know that that person is going to know it was them that requested the change and therefore doesn't want to allow the committee to recommend it. So these are common problems that committees face, and so to me it's much more of a function of the form of a committee as the site to which we have said, yes, this is a legitimate form of making decisions, without really opening the box and seeing what's going on in there. And that's what Laura Stark's doing in the US, and what I'm trying to do to a different degree, because my Mandarin and my Thai are not, you know, fluent yet across Asia.
So how can integrity, what can be done to promote a better internalization of integrity? What could research organizations do?
It's a good question. I wouldn't quite contrast regulation and integrity, more standards, because of the way standards have this close relationship with the scientific mode of thinking. But in terms of what institutions can do, I think the most important thing is to remember that scientists are people and smart people. And so introducing ideas of integrity or discussing integrity requires perhaps modes of engagement that are not common within scientific discussion and academic practice. Because imagining yourself into a scenario is perhaps not what scientists do every day. And I think integrity is something that can actually be productively analysed academically. So we can discuss the genealogy of the term, you can discuss what kind of subject or person it implies that you need to be, you can come up with examples or cases of what would you do in certain scenarios. But I don't know what a culture of integrity looks like, because I think it's a more recent phrasing of a version of ethics. I think discussions about cultures of ethics have been going on for some time, but when you talk about the association between integrity and internalization, that has its own history of what the subject is, and I think that's something that should be in we should be in dialogue as social scientists with academics, scientists about. I think that that doesn't need to be our little secret, but integrity and internalization and has a history of within the sciences. I think that could productively be part of the academic dialogue we have with researchers.
Well, there's this people often speak about nostalgia about the Mestonian, that is the world when the world of science was meant to be fully autonomous and independent.
Mm-hmm.
People would have this common culture.
Mm-hmm.
And then people also speak as if this is a lost paradise,
mm-hmm.
and we now live in a world where the practicing scientists are exposed to many different interests.
Mm-hmm.
And don't you think that in that post-Mestonian world,
mm-hmm.
it may be difficult to pinpoint what is integrity?
Absolutely. Yeah. The second project I mentioned about the implementation of the Danish Code of Conduct of Research Integrity that I'm involved with. My role there is to look at how the term integrity has been introduced through conferences and documents and in dialogue with people. So one of the first activities that we will do is to trace how these different documents define it and in what kinds of histories they place it. Some say integrity is necessary because of research fraud. Some say it's really about misconduct. Some say it's about the culture that you want to generate around science. And I don't think that we have to simplify integrity down to a single thing at all. I think that richness of discussion is actually part of what is intended through reviving the term or reintroducing the term. Then there may be a temptation to oversimplify what integrity is or to provide schemas for it. But perhaps even just having those conversations about what it might mean is already part of fostering that community of discussion and reflection.
Any other comments? Okay, then I think we should just bring this session to a close.